أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله، الحمد لله على حلمه بعد علمه، والحمد لله على عفوه بعد قدرته، والحمد لله على طول أناته في غضبه وهو القادر على ما يريد. الحمد لله حمدا يعادل حمد ملائكته المقربين وأنبيائه المرسلين وعباده الصالحين. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل على محمد. أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره المشركون. اللهم صل على محمد عبدك ورسولك ونجيبك وصفيك، صلاة ترفع بها درجته وتبين بها فضله. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد، وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد، وترحم على محمد وعلى آل محمد، كما صليت وباركت وترحمت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم في العالمين، إنك حميد مجيد. عباد الله، أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله واتباع أمره واجتناب ما نهى عنه. قال تعالى في كتابه الكريم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: والفجر وليال عشر، والشفع والوتر، والليل إذا يسر، هل في ذلك قسم لذي حجر. صدق الله العلي العظيم. Today, Friday, is the first day of the Islamic lunar calendar. We have started the new year in the Islamic calendar, 1439. Of course, many people wonder why this is not associated with celebration, with festive mood, especially in the school of Ahlul Bayt alayhim assalam. Why it's somber? Why so many people are wearing black? Of course, since we have non-Muslim audience in this beautiful gathering, therefore, some of my talk would be directed to them, because it coincides with the martyrdom of the grandson of a prophet, peace be upon him, the beacon of a freedom, the beacon for fairness and equality, the beacon for correctness, Imam Hussein alayhi salam. The verse that I recited are the three or four major verses of Surah Al-Fajr. The Almighty Allah swears by dawn. It says Wal-Fajr. And Fajr is taken the root from bursting, something that breaks out. When the light breaks out in the middle of darkness, in the heart of darkness, in the horizon, is considered to be Fajr or dawn, and then it's spread all over. The Almighty swears by the breakouts and bursts of lightness in the heart of darkness, and then says وَلَيَالٍ عَشْرٍ, the 10 following nights and eve, then they're followed by Fajr, by dawn. Now, the Islamic scholars attribute this event to the first 10 days of the Hajjah, where people perform pilgrimage, where they visit the house of Allah in Mecca, where they, after 10 nights, they are followed by the dawn of Eid, where they sacrifice their sacrificials and then they celebrate. The Almighty Allah has considered this event as the most significant event in the history of a human being. Because on that event, when he ordered his great prophet Abraham to build his house, his holy house, and to explicitly declare for people to visit his holy house and declare monotheism, declare God worshiping in the heart of where the entire land was swamped with idol worshiping, with paganism. So that was a revolution that the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has entrusted his great prophet Abraham to carry over, to build the house of God and to announce for people from all over to visit and to participate in this big demonstration and rally of monotheism, worshiping the Almighty. Where he says, وَإِذْ بَوَّأْنَا لِإِبْرَاهِيمَ مَكَانَ الْبَيْتِ أَلَّا تُشْرِكَ بِي شَيْئًا وَطَهِّرْ بَيْتِيَ لِلطَّائِفِينَ وَالْقَائِمِينَ وَالرُّكَّعِ السُّجُودِ. We have shown to Abraham, or Abraham, the location of this holy house, and have asked him to make it clean and immaculate for those who worship me, those who circle around the house of Kaaba, and those who perform prayers, to be servant to them as they perform the most sacred ritual in their life. So that is considered to be a revolution against darkness. But then immediately after, the verse says, وَالشَّفْعِ وَالْوَتْرِ. What is shaf? Shaf meaning you conjugate things. If there is an event, you conjugate it, you couple it with another event. What is the Almighty trying to say is that this event, this revolution at the dawn of history, is conjugated and twinned with another revolution. Down the road throughout history, you will have another major revolution, another turning point in the history of a human being, that again will do the same thing, will correct people to the path of monotheism. What is that event? Cannot be other than the movement of Hussein ibn Ali alayhi salam. We know that the Prophet, peace be upon him, had his major revolution against idol worshippers, against paganism, when he asked for salvation, when his message was the message of salvation and deliverance of people from the oppression of tyranny, the oppression of idolatry, the oppression of those who subjugate people based on their ethnicities and color. That was the deliverance and the liberation of people. When he brought a message of equality and fairness on the last day of his Hajjatul Wada', on the day of Arafah, the Prophet, peace be upon him, performed a sermon. In his sermon that he gave, which was the last sermon on that pilgrimage, the Prophet, peace be upon him, declared a few things. He said, and that is on that day, that all people, you are all from Adam. Your Lord is one, and your Father is one. You are all brethren, brothers and sisters. أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ إِنَّ رَبَّكُمْ وَاحِدٌ وَإِنَّ أَبَاكُمْ وَاحِدٌ كُلُّكُمْ لِآدَمْ وَآدَمُ مِنْ تُرَابٍ. You all belong to Adam. Adam is your father, and Adam was created from clay. So you're all equal. Inna akramakum 'indallahi atqakum. The best among you, the preferred among you, the most preferred among you are not those by color, are not those by tongue, are not those by financial status, Rather, inna akramakum indallahi atqakum. The best of you, the one who fears God the most. That is the person who is considered to be the best. The one with piety. وَلَيْسَ لَعَرَبِيٍّ عَلَىٰ عَجَمِيٍّ فَضْلٌ إِلَّا بِالتَّقْوَىٰ. There is no preference for Arab over non-Arab except in piety. When there is a piety, then that person considered to be better than others. Other than that, there is no preference among people. That was the last word of the Prophet, who gave it to the masses of Muslims who came to perform the ritual of Hajj on the 10th of Hijrah. Now, that was the message that he has delivered. But unfortunately and regrettably, right after his demise, right after his departure, again, jahiliyyah, ignorance, and paganism came forcefully. But of course, with different outfit this time. It was not as the old one. Rather, it got a new shape, a new outfit, where the Almighty says, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ أَفَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلًا قَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ. When the Prophet dies and demises, you revert back again to the same old habits. If from the year of 11 of Hijrah until the year of 61 of Hijrah, those who took Islam, and of course Bani Umayyah was spearheading this movement, they have changed everything. The Islam that the Prophet, peace be upon him, has brought and introduced to the masses has been adulterated, has been changed. In the school of thought of Ahlul Bayt, where they established this school of thought, and they made a philosophy for that school of thought, and they brought theoreticians and ideologues to theorize for this new religion and new faith, in them, that inactivity and stillness of masses and people and nation is a preferred over their mobility. People need to be static. They should accept the status quo. Whatever the tyrant, whatever the ruler commits and do, the people, the masses, should coexist with that. They should accept it as their own faith. They should not challenge the rule of the Khalifa. They should not object to his creed, to his work. The latest fatwa, brothers and sisters, when you look at the line of Bani Umayyah, the latest fatwa that they have given, which is under the auspices of the Grand Mufti of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, they tell you, you're not allowed to speak against the tyrant, against the ruler, because he is Khalifa, he's succeeding the Prophet, he's representing the Prophet, and you have no right to challenge him, to question him, to perform assemblies and rallies and write columns in newspaper to weaken his God-given authority. This is acts of a blasphemy. You should accept that. You should learn how to coexist with this kind of rule. Even if he's unjust. Even if he is corrupt. And now, of course, they fakely talk about different words of the Prophet that he has made it to them, telling them, do not object and do not challenge the rule of the tyrant. They say, one day the Prophet said, سَيَكُونُ عَلَيْكُمْ أُمَرَاءَ مِنْ بَعْدِي. After me, I will be succeeded with a bunch of rulers who are ظَلَمَةٌ لَا يَرْعَوْنَ حَقَّ اللَّهِ فِيكُمْ. They are unjust, oppressors, and they never fear God in your situation, meaning that they oppress you, they plunder your belongings, and they take away your rights. قالوا ما نصنع يا رسول الله. Then in that case, what should we do, O the Prophet? He said, أدوا إليهم حقهم. Give them their rights. What is their rights? Their God-given rights of rule, meaning allow them. Do not become an obstacle to their way of governance. Allow them to rule. وَاسْأَلُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّكُمْ. But just go inside the masjid and raise your hand and pray to God so He can take them away. This type of Islam, this type of religion is a static religion, telling people stay dormant, be sedated. You have no right to move. You cannot have mobility. You cannot advance. You cannot talk against the ruler, because God has given him this authority and you have to accept it. That was the dominant view after the demise of the Prophet until the year of 61 of Hijrah. At that time, when came the revolution of Hussein ibn Ali. Ali Hussein said, enough of this. Enough of this, because Islam, the way that we have understood it, is different than what you have brought it, O Bani Umayyah. I have heard the Prophet, peace be upon him, with my ears, that he said, أيها الناس من رأى منكم سلطانا جائرا مستحلا لحرم الناس. O people, if you have witnessed a single tyrant, a sultan, a ruler that is ruthless, that doesn't abide himself by the rule of God and that tradition of the Prophet, ناكثا لي عهد الله, he renegade against the covenant of God, مخالفا لسنة رسول الله, opposing the tradition of the Prophet, يعمل في عباد الله بالإثم والعدوان, he works with sedition against his people and population, فلم يغير, whoever witnessed that person, witnessed that ruler, and does not do anything, does not try to change the status quo, that does not alter the situation, God would equate him with that ruthless leader, with that ruthless ruler. And I am the one who will change. My objective here is reformation. I am here to reform, to bring a change, to blow a new spirit in the nations, even if that's considered to be taking my life away. Because in my eyes, life is when I die in dignity. And death is when I live in a humility under the subjugation of the ruler. إني لا أرى الموت إلا سعادة. In his word, he says, أَلَا تَرَوْنَ إِلَى الْحَقِّ لَا يُعْمَلُ بِهِ. Don't you see that rightness is not been adopted? وَإِلَى الْبَاطِلِ لَا يُتَنَاهَا عَنْهِ. The vice is been continuing and being adopted. أَلَا تَرَوْنَ إِلَى الْحَقِّ لَا يُعْمَلُ بِهِ وَإِلَى الْبَاطِلِ لَا يُتَنَاهَا عَنْهِ لِيَذْهَبَ الْمُؤْمِنُ مُحِقًّا إِلَى رَبِّهِ أَلَا وَإِنِّي لَا أَرَى الْمَوْتِ إِلَّا سَعَادَةً. I don't see death, but a victory, a happiness, when I die with my own will. وَالْحَيَاةِ مَعَ الظَّالِمِينَ إِلَّا بَرَمَا. The life in a humility, in defamation with the rulers is nothing but death. This is what I am. أَلَا وَإِنَّ الدَّعِيَّ ابْنَ الدَّعِيِّ قَدْ رَكَزَ بَيْنَ اثْنَتَيْنِ بَيْنَ السِّلَّةِ وَالذِّلَّةِ وَهَيْهَاتْ مِنَّ الذِّلَّةِ. The ruler has made a choice for me. Either I accept his allegiance with a humility, or I fight until death. And I would not choose anything But dignity with a dignified life and dignified death. هيهات من الذلة يأبى الله لنا ذلك ورسوله والمؤمنون وحجور طابت وطهرت وأنوف حمية ونفوس أبية أن نؤثر طاعة اللئام على مصارع الكرام. I am here to save you. I am here to reform. We are not cattle. We are not animals that we just make our daily lives and normal life and then we die. We have to live with dignity. We have to live with respect. That's when you look at the epic of Karbala Ashura. You see the followers of Hussein alayhi salam. They were so steadfast, believing in the cause, resisting the enemy until the last drop of their blood. Look at the old, the elderly. Look at the child. Look at the teen. Look at the woman. All walks of life have participated in this great revolution of Hussein. One of them is Muslim ibn Awsaja. Muslim, a 70 years old man. In the battle, he fought until he collapsed. Habib and Hussein walked toward him. Habib is telling him, Ya Muslim, لولا أني أعلم لم أكن في الأثر لطلبت أن تنصحني. If you decide, if you tell me what is your will, choose. What would you like? I know that I will be dead after you. But if you have something in your mind, if you want to tell your will, I am ready here to hear about you. He says, he points toward Hussein ibn Ali and says, عليك بهذا الغريب. Take care of this man. Shed your blood for the sake of this man. Another incident. One of the men, the companions of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein, Amr ibn Junada, he participated in the battle and was killed. His son, a 14-year-old son, came to Imam Hussein, dressed up in the outfit of the battle, came to fight. Hussein looked at him, a 14-year-old teenager. He sent him back to his mother, told him, go back. There are fighters who will fight in behalf of me. You don't need to fight your fight. You know, your mother have lost your father. Go back to the tent. She said, he said, Sayyidi, wallah ummi allati ba'athatni. It is my mother who made me wear this and came to fight. She was the one who have asked me to come and defend you, ya ibn Rasulillah. He took him back to the tent. His mother came back and told him, Ya Imam Hussein, he is my son in the same way that Zahra, your mother, would witness your killing. I would like to witness the killing of my son in your way, in your path. That was Umar, that was Abdullah ibn Amr ibn Junada. When he went to the battle, charged to the enemy, he looked at Imam Hussein and told him, Mawlai, take my mother to the tent of your women. She's going to be part of your ladies. She will be captivated. She will be captive in the same way as your sisters, your wife, and your daughters will be captive. That were the great companions of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إنا أعطيناك الكوثر فصل لربك وانحر إن شانئك هو الأبتر. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والحمد لله رب العالمين نحمده ونستعينه ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ به من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأن محمدًا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره المشركون اللهم صل على محمد عبدك ورسولك وحبيبك ونجيك وخيرتك من خلقك وصل اللهم على علي أمير المؤمنين ووصي رسول رب العالمين عبدك ووليك وأخي رسولك وصل على الصديقة الطاهرة فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين وصل على سبطي الرحمة وإمامي الهدى الحسن والحسين سيدي شباب أهل الجنة وصل على أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي والخلف الهادي المهدي عجل الله تعالى فرجه وسهل مخرجه وجعلنا من أنصاره وأعوانه عباد الله أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله واتباع أمره واجتناب ما نهى عنه ورد عن سيدنا ومولانا أبي عبد الله الصادق عليه السلام أنه قال اقرأوا سورة الفجر في فرائضكم ونوافلكم فإنها سورة الحسين بن علي عليهما السلام وارغبوا فيها رحمكم الله من أدمن قراءتها كان مع الحسين في درجته في الجنة إمام الصادق عليه السلام said keep reciting the chapter of Fajr, the one that I recited in my first sermon. He said, keep reciting that because that chapter belongs to Hussein ibn Ali alayhi salam. One of the audience told him, how is that possible, ya ibn Rasulillah? Then the Imam al-Sadiq says, أَلَا تَسْمَعُ قَوْلَهُ تَعَالَى يَا أَيَّتُهَا النَّفْسُ الْمُطْمَئِنَّةِ ارجعي إلى ربك راضية مرضية وادخلي في عبادي وادخلي جنتي. You didn't hear the verse where it say, oh, the reassured soul, return back to your Lord and inhabit the paradise. That verse belongs to Imam al-Hussein because he had the certain soul. The reassured soul. What is النفس المطمئنة? What is this reassured soul that Quran talks about? The reassured soul, it is a soul that reaches certainty. When you reach certainty, the highest, the ultimate position and state of any soul, that is considered to be certain, yaqeen. In that state, you will be able to see the puzzles, the secrets of this universe, the secrets of the creation. You will be able to see heavens and hells by your eyes. As the verse in Surah At-Takathur, it says, كَلَّا لَوْ تَعْلَمُونَ عِلْمَ الْيَقِينَ لَتَرَوُنَّ الْجَحِيمَ. If you reach the status of certainty, the reassured soul, then you will be able to see the hellfire by your eyes. That is the reassured soul. كَلَّا لَوْ تَعْلَمُونَ عِلْمَ الْيَقِينَ لَتَرَوُنَّ الْجَحِيمَ ثُمَّ لَتَرَوُنَّهَا عَيْنَ الْيَقِينَ ثُمَّ لَتُسْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَئِذٍ عَنِ النَّعِيمِ. In this life, before the hereafter, if you reach this state of certainty and the reassured soul, then you will become in a way to see the puzzles of this creation. You will see the entire universe in its reality, in its factual state. Let's go back and see the story of Abraham with his Lord. Ibrahim alayhi salam, at one moment he asked his Lord, he said, Rabbi arini kayfa tuhyil mawta. How do you reincarnate and resurrect the dead? How would you bring life to the dead? The Almighty told him, Ibrahim, you have not came to believe? You have not believed in this? What was the answer? He said, yes, but not quite sure. I have belief, but I have not reached the status of certainty. قال بلى ولكن ليطمئن قلبي اطمئنان. Remember in the first verse says نفس المطمئن, the one that has reached that reassured state. Here Ibrahim عليه السلام says that I have not reached that level yet. I want to witness that by my eyes. At that time when God tells him, take 4 pigeons, slaughter them, chop them off, and then distribute them on 10 mountains, and then call upon them, invite them as they all gather and get back to you. And that was Ibrahim alayhi salam. But until that moment, Ibrahim has not reached the level of certainty, the level of the reassured soul. When did he reach that? The Almighty talks about the incident later on. It says that وَكَذَلِكَ نُرِي إِبْرَاهِيمَ مَلَكُوتَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Eventually we showed Ibrahim the true nature of this universe, meaning that he reached the reassured soul. But how did he reach it? After going through great tests, great examinations, God put his servants in a great examinations. If they pass, if they succeed, they reach that great status, the status of certainty, the status of the reassured soul. When did he reach? The Almighty talks about that. The incident when Ibrahim alayhi salam took his son Ismail to slaughter him in the way of Allah. When God asked him, oh Ibrahim, you need to slaughter your son. The ayah says, وَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَعَهُ السَّعْيَ قَالَ يَا بُنَيَّ إِنِّي أَرَى فِي الْمَنَامِ أَنِّي أَذْبَحُكَ. I have seen in my dreams that I am slaughtering you. فَانْظُرْ مَاذَا تَرَى. What is your idea? What's your opinion? Immediately the son said, يَا أَبَتِ فْعَلْ مَا تُؤْمَرْ سَتَجِدُنِي إِنْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مِنَ الصَّابِرِينَ. If this is the command of your Lord, I submit to the command of Lord. Do it. Do not wait. Ibrahim alayhi salam took his son, the young son, toward outskirts of the town without notifying his mother about his action, what he wants to do. At that time, Ismail tells his father, tells him, I have 3 requests from you. Now that I am submitting and you are submitting to the will of Lord, I have 3 requests. Number 1, I want you to tie me up. Tie me up because I will kick. I will move. If I will kick and move, the mercy of your fatherly state will get into your heart and maybe you will stop from executing God's order. I want you to finish, therefore tie me up very well. Then, if you want to butcher me, put my forehead against the stone. Do not butcher me right as you look at me. Why, son? Because if you look at my eyes, maybe the mercy again of your fatherly state will be so strong that you stop from executing that order. What is the third one? The third one, take my shirt. I did not say farewell to my mother. Take my shirt, so she can keep it as a memory of me. At that time, that was the greatest test that the Almighty has put his servants Ibrahim and Ismail, where the ayah says, in the aftermath, it says, وَلَمَّا أَسْلَمَا وَتَلَّهُ لِلْجَبِينَ وَنَادَيْنَاهُ أَنْ يَا إِبْرَاهِيمَ قَدْ صَدَّقْتَ الرُّؤْيَا إِنَّا كَذَلِكَ نَجْزِي الْمُحْسِنِينَ إِنَّ هَذَا لَهُوَ الْبَلَاءُ الْمُبِينَ. This is the most difficult, the most challenging test, that someone slaughter his son for the sake of Lord. But that time, the Lord told him, stop, Ibrahim. You have passed the test. There is no need for you to continue. There is a sheep, and slaughter the sheep as a ransom for your son. And Ibrahim, by that time, was elevated to the status of certainty. Now let's ask, how did Hussein ibn Ali has reached this status of certainty? How he became nafs al-mutma'in? Again, in the battle of Karbala, Imam Hussein facing the enemy was 72, but the first one who charged to the enemy from his household was his son Ali al-Akbar. Hussein ibn Ali, not only he asked his son to fight, to be charging to enemy and fight for the sake of Islam, rather he witnessed by his eyes the decapitation of the body of his son. He witnessed the obliteration of the body of his son. He witnessed the mass killing of his household, yet he stood very strong in front of the enemy. On the minute that he fell from the horse, he laid on the ground. Four arrows have punctured his body. One has punctured his heart and came out from back. That was number one. The other arrow punctured his neck. A third one his throat. And fourth one his jaws. He's laying on the ground. His forehead was shattered. His skull was fractured. People with dagger stabbed him in his sides. And Imam al-Baqir says that there were 1900 strikes and stabs on the body of Hussein ibn Ali. One companion said, "Is it impossible? 1900 stabs and the strikes on the body of Hussein? How is that possible?" Al-Baqir said, "Al-darbatu ala al-darba, wa-ta'natu ala al-ta'na, a stab over a stab, a strike over a strike." The entire body of Hussein was decapitated. His chest was broken, laying on the ground. The enemy said at that time, "I looked at the lips of Hussein, are saying something, talking, murmuring, but I cannot hear. I said, this man is cursing us. God, I swear by God, if this man is cursing us, no one will be saved." As I approached him, as I got close to him, I saw him saying, "Bismillah wa billah, wa fi sabilillahi wa ala millati rasulillah. Sabran ala qadaika ya Rabb." I am patient. I have forbearance. Sabran ala qadaika ya Rabb. La ma'bud siwak aghithni ya ghiyath al mustaghithin. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al aliyy al azim. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Assalamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah wa ala al-arwah allati halat bifina'ik wa anakhat birahlik. Alaykum minni jami'an salamullahi abadan ma baqitu wa baqiya al-layl wa al-nahar ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح ورأيت الناس يدخلون في دين الله أفواجا فسبح بحمد ربك واستغفره إنه كان توابا. صدق الله العلي العظيم.